Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to WCC. There we go. Good morning. Welcome to WCC, everyone. It's great to see you today. Great to have you with us. We're going to get service started in a few moments, so if you can make your way to your seats, that would be wonderful. There are a number of announcements I want to share with you. This time of year, as many of you are aware, can be quite busy, and so there's a lot of stuff even on the docket for us as a church. So a couple of announcements I just ask you to be pay special attention to, maybe mark them down in your calendars for some of the events that are upcoming. The first couple of things are cancellations, actually. So Monday night, tomorrow night's girls group is going to be canceled, but it will resume next week. And so if you have a young person who's involved in that, let them know. That's canceled for tomorrow. And then Carl Wilson's Bible study is canceled as well. So Carl and Mary, theirs is going to be canceled for tonight. So if you're part of their Bible study, don't show up. They won't have dinner ready for you. Sorry. Not this week anyway. I want to make you aware, especially you moms, Mom's Night Out is coming up next Saturday, March the 23rd, 7 o'clock at Minot's house. And if you don't know where Minot and Eric live, you could talk to me afterwards or check your email. I'm pretty sure that Becky would have included the address in there. Or if you see Eric or Minot around, you could even talk to them too. But Mom's Night Out next Saturday, 7 o'clock at Minot's house. The theme is food. Bring finger food and something that you can dip in. So that'll be great. Our Good Friday service is also coming up very fast. And for those of you who've been with us in the past, you know that we like to do a breakfast on Good Friday. So come and join us for that. We also have a worship service to follow. And what we're asking for again this year is if you can help out at all in donating any of the breakfast foods that we need, that would be great. There are sign-up sheets at the entrances. So if you could take a look at those and see if there's something you could put your name to help us bring, that would be wonderful. We'd appreciate that. You can bring them to the church here, put them in the back where the kind of the new kitchen is labeled in the back there. It'd be wonderful. A couple of more events I want to make you aware of. Trivia night is going to be coming up April 6th. It's only actually 3 or 4 weeks away. So if you would like to be part of the trivia night, what you can do is a couple of different things. You can either make your own team. If you've got a group of people you know you'd like to participate with, make a team of 4 to 6 people and kind of let us know ahead of time. But if you don't have a team that you know that you want to be part of, you can just show up that night. Show up with yourself, your friends, your family, whoever you want to come with, and we'll just place you on a team, or we'll make you your own team, or however that's going to work. But please come and join us. It's a great night. We started it last year. We had a lot of fun with it. We filled up the library with people, about 50 or so people, so we had a great time. So trivia night is coming up April the 6th, so you can mark your calendar for that in the evening. WCC soccer registration is actually officially closed at this point, but I'm still looking for volunteers. So if you'd like to help us with that program and volunteer to be an assistant coach or a coach or just help in any kind of way, we'd greatly appreciate that. You can sign up as a volunteer at waterfordsoccer.com. Right now we have about 20 volunteers and we need about 40 volunteers to make the program operate well and run smoothly. So we've got a couple of months to get that all set up. But if you're able to help and you haven't signed up yet, that would be wonderful. If you need more information about the soccer program, I don't have time this morning to get into all the details, you can just talk to me afterwards. I'd be happy to share with you what the program's all about. A few more things here. Men's retreat is coming up, and many of you men have already signed up for it. And we've had kind of a record year already with signups. So I've opened up the registration a little bit more so that we can have about 30 guys sign up for it. So there's still some space available. If you haven't signed up yet, I'd encourage you to do so as soon as possible because those spots are filling up fast, and we only have a certain number of them reserved at MBC for that. The cost is $210. It's for June 21st to 23rd. That's Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And so your meals are provided, a lot of the amenities there. It's lots of fun to just get to do different sports and leisure activities. We do volleyball, there's pickleball, there's tennis, there's all sorts of different things, more than I could even list even now. But if you want to be part of that, please sign up on the front hallway at the sign-up sheet here. And then I'm also asking some of you guys, because we already have 22 guys signed up, if some of you could get me your registration fees sooner rather than later, that would be wonderful. The main reason for that is I've got to send a deposit into MBC soon, by the end of this month. And so if you could get yours forwarded to me sooner rather than later, if you're able to, that would be a great help to me. That way we can get our spot kind of all secure and reserved and set up for that. So that's the men's retreats. Then lastly, we have Christian Service Center banquet coming up that one of our deacons here, Kevin Miles, helps out with. And so he wanted to let us know this morning, April the 8th, right? Yeah, April the 8th is Christian Service Center banquet. And so again, if many of you like to be part of that in the past, if you'd like to be part of it again, you can contact him, talk to Kevin. Kevin, you just wave your hand real quick. If anyone doesn't know who he is, that's the guy to talk to. You can get tickets. I don't think the tickets cost anything, but you can just donate, yeah, when you're there at the banquet. And so anyway, more details from Kevin. There's a flyer up in the hallway as well if you want to get more details about the banquet itself. So thanks, Kevin, for bringing that to my attention too. Before we go into worship this morning, though, there is one more thing. We're going to hear from one of the missionaries that we support in the Belma family. And so Minna and Michelle Belma, they're with ABWE. They used to be missionaries to Portugal, and now they've kind of come home, and Minna became the president of ABWE Canada, and now he's the president of ABWE for like the entire U.S. division, which kind of takes care of everything under it as well. So Minna is part of that, Michelle as well. And so they're going to share with us through a quick video, just letting us know how ministry's been going with them. And so we want to thank our missions committee for keeping us, you know, up to date on many of those missionaries that are out in the field and even back at home doing a lot of things for the kingdom. And so let's just take a few moments now to hear from Minna and Michelle, and we'll see what's going on in their lives.
Hi, Waterford community. It's Min and Michelle Bauma. We're recording from ABWE International Headquarters just outside Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. We're so thankful for the opportunity to be able to share with you and give you a little picture of what ministry looks like for us and let you know how you can pray for us. We love your church and are just so thankful for the relationships that we have with you. And you are very valued as part of our support team. So Minna, why don't you share what's going on behind us?
Yes, so you can see behind me, as we look at all these individuals that are here today, we're having a 24-hour demo where people come in on a Friday evening and learn more about ABWE and whether they're thinking about being missionaries, whether they're thinking about supporting missionaries, or whether it's pastors or a missions team that is interested in missions. They come here and learn more about what ABWE does in missions around the world.
Hey, did you guys know that ABWE Canada is hosting a similar event? It's the weekend of May 3rd and 4th. We would love to see you there. Min and I are going to be there and be some of the presenters. So take a look on the ABWE Canada website and sign up to join us.
As well, in the next few days, we have ABWE board meetings. I'm involved as a vice president and to give a report to the board about the different areas that I look after, specifically the ministries overseas, and then, of course, also some healthcare, missionary security levels, and then, of course, we've got aviation. So there's a lot of different pieces to that, so we're excited about that. We would also love some prayer for that as well because of the presentations that we're meeting today.
Yeah, Minna has the cool job of being able to brag on a lot of our missionaries and tell their cool stories. So as soon as board meetings are finished, we hug right to the airport and get on a plane. We're headed to Togo, West Africa, where Min and I get to do my favorite part of this role, and that is visit missionaries in their homes and see them active in their ministry sites. We are traveling something like 1,200 kilometers by road. That's after we actually fly to Togo, but are just so looking forward to being an encouragement and a help to our teams there.
And while we're there, we actually get to be part of the 50th celebration of ABWE being in Togo. We're super excited about that and just all the different parts that will be involved. But we also want to realize that because of the legacy of sending and supporting churches like yourselves, Waterford, that makes that possible for missionaries to be able to do that. Your legacy of supporting missionaries like us allows a 50th celebration of serving overseas to happen. So Michelle and I just want to say thank you for being one of our supporting churches. Thank you for sacrificially partnering with us. And we're so excited about you. Know that we pray for you and we love you all. Have a great day.
Hope to see you soon.
Well, it's quite possible that later this year we're actually going to be able to see from Minute and Michelle in person, because he's already contacted me to let me know about some of the furlough times that they're going to be back in Canada. Canada's their hometown or their home country, and right here in Ontario as well. And so we might be able to see from them in person this coming year. Now, Minna and Michelle, they're involved in a much more administrative role now in the role that they do. And so as you heard, they do a lot of traveling around, visiting missionaries. But Minna also gets the fun task of sitting in board meetings. As some of you are well aware, that's not exactly the most glamorous position to be in. But in leadership, it's a very important position to be in, because there are many decisions that have to be made at that level that trickle down and affect many of the other missionaries part of ABWE. So please continue to keep them in prayer for those administrative roles that they're involved in, and for the traveling and visiting and encouraging that they do together. So I don't know about you, but sometimes at the end of announcements, I feel out of breath. I'm sure you don't feel out of breath at the end of announcements, because you're not the one giving them, but maybe you felt that way during the week, or maybe it's a bit of an analogy about how life goes for you during the week as well. You get to the weekend or Sunday morning and you feel out of breath. And this is the time that can seem challenging to unwind and to focus your mind on the important task of worshiping God. Now, the Bible describes this activity as a taste of what God has for us in the eternal age. The Bible describes it as a time of rest. Maybe Sunday mornings don't feel like a time of rest for you, but that's not because the Bible wants us to just put our feet up and do nothing. The idea of rest is that we would be at peace and harmony with our God, that our hearts and minds would be connected intentionally to Him, and most importantly, worshiping Him together. So if you feel out of breath like me, hopefully you can pause for a moment as we pray to lay those burdens at God's feet, to bring them to Him, and to prepare your heart to be able to worship Him intentionally and meaningfully this morning. So let's do that now. If you're able, please stand with me, and we're going to go to God in prayer and commit our time and service to Him. Heavenly Father, as we bow before you this morning, we want to just first thank you for your great goodness and grace towards us, as we see it demonstrated in the cross of Jesus. Father, as He died on our behalf and secured the atonement of sin so that we could be forgiven and be in Your presence, Lord, not just now, but forever, we thank You for this great and powerful gospel truth. And I pray that that would be the forefront of our minds this morning as we worship You. That whatever cares and burdens or strife and turmoil we face throughout the week, we would be able to bring those burdens to You and find a semblance of rest, knowing that You're sovereign Lord over all, that if You've rescued us from sin and death and hell, You can certainly rescue us from the other things of this world that are troublesome to us. So, Father, we lay them at Your feet, and we pray that You would indeed bring us this great peace and a sense of Your presence this morning. We want to also lift up Minna and Michelle to You, Father, that You would make them effective for service as they travel around, and even as they travel to Togo soon, that, Lord, You'd make them effective in the conferences and the board meetings that Minna heads up, that it would be to Your glory and honor, that the kingdom would grow through those efforts. Father, we pray to that end for our church as well, that You would prepare us and equip us, even today in the worship service, that we'd be ready to share with others the good news of the gospel of Jesus. Help us to be centered on You today. Help us to see who You are, to see Your nature and glory and Your Son, Jesus, revealed to us through Your word and through song, and that we, Father, would return praise to You, that it be pleasing in Your sight. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning, church family. It's great to be with you, and welcome to the new families that are here. I see some new faces, and we want to welcome you, and it's great to have you a part of this Sunday service. We want to cast our mind to something about God this morning. And I don't know if you've been kind of caught up with your relationship with God and thinking, what do I got to do to earn God's favor? You ever asked that question to yourself? I hope you haven't. But in this world, we go through life where we've got to put effort in to get something in return, right? We've got a job, we've got to go to work, put effort in, and then we get a reward. How is it with our relationship with God, though? It's not that way, is it? No. We learned a couple Sundays ago, there was a verse. How are we saved? By what? By grace. You are saved through faith. There is nothing we really have to do other than to believe and to serve God. We can't do anything to gain his favor. He already loves us. So we're going to cast our mind to those things this morning. May we lay aside any burden that we've got to perform or be something more than who God has made us to be. So let's sing together, Your Grace is Enough.
Your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's restless heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy, and nothing can keep us apart.
Now, do we take that for granted, church family? No, we shouldn't. No, we shouldn't take that for granted, because what we should do in response to that is to say, thank you, God. You have freed me from all of this burden of sin. So now I get to say, yes, I will. I'm made new. And we're going to carry forward together. And today we're going to talk, I think, about unity and love together as a church family. So together, let's sing this song, Yes, I Will.
I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out, working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. For joy when my heart is heavy for all my days. Yes, I will. I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me. Thank you. judge and our defender, suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light. Forever seated.
Last song we'll sing in preparation for the message this morning is In Christ Alone.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Alone. cry to final breath. Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever blot me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of
may be seated. For those of you with young children who like to participate in our junior church program, come on up front.
All right. Good to see you this morning. Yeah, it can be a little bit scary coming up front, but don't worry. You're going to be able to go have lots of fun. You're going to learn about Jesus and do some memory verses, and your leaders are going to have a great time being able to teach you more about God. So let's bow in a word of prayer, and then we'll have you dismissed. You can go over to junior church, okay? We won't make you perform a song this morning. Is that okay? All right, maybe next week. We'll have to wait. When Amy's here, she'll do one for you, okay? Anyway, let's pray, and then you can be dismissed over. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the young people in our church, these children who you're drawing to yourself. We pray, and we believe, Lord, that as they learn more and more about you, that their hearts will be softened to come to know the truth of the gospel and have true saving faith in you. So we pray to that end, pray that you'd give the leaders the grace and understanding to be able to communicate the gospel to them effectively, and then that, Father, you would simply help them to see the beauty of your son Jesus and all that they're doing even now. We pray this in Jesus' name, amen. As they're making their way out, we are going to get into the Word of God this morning. And so before we do just that, why don't we bow in a word of prayer, and we'll just commit this time to the Lord that He would bless the understanding of His Word. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do come to you this morning thankful that you have provided us everything we need to understand you and your will for us here in your Word. And so we pray that this morning our ears would be open, our hearts would be ready to just take in everything that you have for us. Help us to be listening, Lord, to what you have to say. And then, Father, just convict us by your Spirit that we would live out what we learned today. We pray this all for your glory. In the name of Jesus, amen. If you have your Bibles, I want to encourage you to open them to Ephesians chapter 2. We continue on in our series studying the book of Ephesians. One of the key verses that I think helps us understand the purpose of the book of Ephesians, it comes in chapter 3, verse 21, and I've read this a number of times, but the Apostle Paul prays that the church will be strengthened to know Christ and to have the fullness of God dwell in them. So in Ephesians 3, verse 19, it says that you would know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. And I believe the book of Ephesians is written to help the church understand how to be that church that is demonstrating the fullness of God, that is seeing the presence of God lived out in their lives. To be unified together as one body, not just separate, divided people groups like the Jewish Christians worshiping their own way and the Gentile Christians worshiping their own way, but that there be no division, that they would come together and demonstrate the full unity of faith and the fullness of God together as a church body. And so that's what we've been talking about in the book of Ephesians. And as Matt mentioned a couple of weeks ago, we did cover a few of those very, very powerful verses, maybe the most recognizable verses in all of Ephesians, in chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, for by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not your own doing, it's the gift of God. Well, we're going to move on from that great gospel declaration into the Apostle Paul's appeal for the church to remain united together, to remind them about the separation that they had from God, but that has been now healed and mended through the work of Jesus so that they might grow up together into this beautiful temple, this holy dwelling place for the Lord. And so we're going to read Ephesians 2, verses 11 through 22. Again, if you have your Bibles there, I'd encourage you to follow along, but the words, the scripture is going to be up on the screen as well, and you can follow along there. Reading out of the English Standard Version, beginning in verse 11, the Word of God says, "Therefore, remember that at one time, you Gentiles in the flesh called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands. Remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and preached peace to you who are far off, and peace to those who are near. For through him we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit." What is God up to? That's the title of the message this morning. For those of you who are taking notes and like to know, what is God up to? Now, me and Stephanie have four younger children, and so that doesn't really afford us an awful lot of time to sleep in the mornings. Saturday mornings tends to be like that one morning in the week that we have an opportunity to. Not saying that it gets to happen, but it's the one morning where there's an opportunity to sleep a little bit later than you normally would. And so our kids will typically get up at 6 or 6:30, and we might on Saturday then get to sleep in a little bit later than that, maybe. And like, it's not like it's scheduled or anything, but it could potentially happen. However, on Saturday mornings, what typically happens is the kids will then get up before us. It just happens because we're asleep, and then they just get up and do their thing. And the older ones kind of know the rules, what they're supposed to do and not do. But the younger ones, the smaller pitter-pattering of the feet, those are the ones you've got to be concerned about getting into trouble. What almost always wakes you up immediately is the grating sound of a chair being slid across the room in the kitchen. As you know, any of you who are parents, that the sliding chair is bad news. It means that there are kids, they're trying to get into things that they shouldn't get into. And so your ears perk up immediately, and the first thing that comes to mind is, what are they up to? What are they up to? What are they going to get into? Are they trying to get into the freezer? Are they trying to get into the upper cupboards where the chips and the goodies are kind of all stored? What are they getting up to? Have you ever wondered that about God? What is God up to? We hear some rumblings. We see some movement. We hear some things. What is God doing? Not just in your life as an individual Christian. That's important to think about too. But more importantly, for us as a church to wonder, what is God up to with the church? I believe Ephesians 2 verses 11 through 22 give us a good understanding of that. Help us to answer that question, what is God up to? What has he been up to? And what is he doing now? Ephesians 2, 11 and 22 give us the picture of God's intentions, his purpose, and his plan for the church. And so this morning, as we think more about that, my aim is that we would come to know, or know more clearly, the plan that God has for his holy dwelling place. That's what he calls us, the church, his holy dwelling place. Not the church building, not the bricks and mortar of this place, but the people of the church, God calls his holy dwelling place. So then let's talk about what God is up to. The first thing, the way the Apostle Paul begins this passage of Scripture is by pointing out the bad news again, or reminding the church and the people of the church where they once were relative to God before Christ came. So he says in verse 12, "Remember that you, who are the Gentiles, the uncircumcised of the flesh, were called by the Jewish people, those who are circumcised in their flesh, you Gentiles, which is all non-Jewish people, you Gentiles were called by the Jewish people. You were far off, separated. That's the way the Jewish people referred to us, Gentiles. Separate from, different than. There was this wall of division between Gentile and Jewish person. There's a distinction then. And verse 11 brings that out. One of the distinctions has to do with the covenants, the covenant of promise given to the Jewish people that God gave to Abraham so many years prior, and then to Moses through the law. So there's a clear distinction that the Apostle Paul is reminding us, the church, about. At one time, we were not part of these wonderful promises and covenants that God had initially given to Israel. We were far off. So the end of verse 12, it says, remember, you were one time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope without God in the world. Now, a non-Jewish person could come into the Israelite fold, so to speak. It was rather rare, but it could happen, even in the Old Testament. And we might refer to this as like proselytizing, the act of going from one religion to the other, where someone would go from a pagan cultish religion of the world and then come into the Jewish faith of some kind. It happened. It was very rare, but it did happen. And it was allowed in the law for a stranger or an alien or a foreigner of Israel to come and worship God. But according to the Old Testament law, there wasn't really any way for that foreigner to be counted as one of Israel. They could participate in worship if they followed the right rules and regulations, but they were really still considered an outsider. They could still come under the blessing of Israel. They could still come under the good leadership, if there was good leadership. They could come under the good laws of Israel that God helped establish, but they were still very much viewed as an outsider. There was some rare, rare instances where this kind of changed. Think of Rahab, at Ruth, as they're kind of married into and become part of the line of Jesus. But again, those are quite rare instances, and quite often the outsider was just that. They are alienated from Israel. But that's all about to change with the person of Jesus Christ. We'll get into that in a few moments. But the first thing to recognize is this word hopelessness that the Apostle Paul reminds the people of the church about. You once had no hope, being without God. Before Christ, then, all non-Jewish people, that's us all Gentiles, we were separated from the promises of God, hopelessly lost in sin. And this is a point we've talked about, of course, in virtually every message here in the book of Ephesians, because virtually every passage of Scripture talks about or deals with this idea of God saving us from sin into His holy presence. And so we've talked about sin. We've talked about being separated from God. The beginning of chapter 2, you're dead in your trespasses and sins in which you once walked. So we've talked about this. I'm not going to belabor the point too much, other than that the Apostle Paul is reminding us of our position relative to God before Jesus. Alienated, separated from His promises, separated and then hopelessly lost. There's no chance for the person outside of Israel. So how do we become one of them? Well, we might try to join in their rituals and worship, but I am still never, as a foreigner, going to get to enjoy the inheritance of Israel. Hey, especially as a male. Like, I'm going to try to come into the nation of Israel. They might let me worship with them. I'm not going to have an inheritance, though. The inheritance of Israel belongs to Israel. The inheritance of the land belonged to Israel and the Israelite people. So I might be able to participate in some semblance, but I'm not really part of it. And this is the point the Apostle Paul's making, that all people outside of the commonwealth of Israel had this hopelessness about them. How could we possibly enter into something that's been given to Israel and seemingly Israel alone? Remember the hopelessness that you were once in. I believe, you see, hopelessness can actually be a good thing. Almost always we think about hopelessness in a bad way because, well, hopelessness just simply feels bad. If you've ever been in the depths of despair or depression and felt hopelessness, you'd probably say right away, well, hopelessness is terrible. Wouldn't wish that on anybody. And sure, yes, from the human point of view, we wouldn't wish that on anyone. But there is a purpose and point to hopelessness, and I think the Apostle Paul is even getting at it here. Hopelessness is one of the key ways in which a person recognizes their need. A person recognizes that they are lost without God and completely and utterly hopeless. Not hopeless in God, hopeless in themselves. Because they're dead to their sin, dead in sin, they cannot resurrect themselves. They cannot get up out of the grave. They cannot make positive movements towards God without the work and act of God in them first. So this sense of hopelessness creeps over us. And the Apostle Paul means this to happen, because when we recognize our hopelessness, it puts us in position then to be able to accept the gracious gift of God. See, a person who feels that they are not hopeless, a person who believes that they are fine in and of themselves and nothing's wrong, will never extend their hand to accept the gift of God because they don't realize how much they need it. So the hopelessness that the Apostle Paul gets across to us is actually a necessary thing. An example of that might be the prodigal son. If you kind of know some of the different parables of Jesus, one of the most famous ones that he gives is the parable of the prodigal son. And in the parable of the prodigal son, the account, the story of the prodigal son, we have a man who's wealthy and he has two sons. One of those sons, the younger, decides foolishly, selfishly, and greedily that he wants to take his inheritance early. I'm not going to wait for dad to die. Dad, give me all of my inheritance now so that I can go and live the life I want to live. The father decides that he's going to give the son his inheritance. So he does. And what does the son do? Well, in the parable of the prodigal son, Jesus says that that son goes and he foolishly squanders and wastes all of the inheritance that was given to him. In fact, the word prodigal in Latin actually means debauchery. We talked about that a few years ago. We actually preached a message on the prodigal son. Now, the Latin word for prodigal actually literally means debauchery, and it's the senseless living that the son lived in, the sinful, senseless living that he lived in. Finally, the son, after wasting all of his money, is surviving by working in a pig pen, feeding pigs, taking care of pigs. He's working basically the lowest job he can think of. Now, if you're a pig farmer in here, I'm not trying to say that that's the lowest job possible, but consider for the Jewish person, you know, pigs are off limits, right? So if you're a Jewish person working in a pig farm, in a pig pen, that's probably the lowest position you could imagine working in. Not that farming is a bad thing, it's an incredibly good thing, but for this man, this prodigal son, it was the lowest place he could be in. In fact, he wasn't just working with the pigs. He found himself in such a low point. He had no money, couldn't afford any food. So what did he start to do? He started craving to eat the food that the pigs were eating. He had gone beyond just even eating pigs. He was eating the food that the pigs ate. How helpless and hopeless do you think that man felt in that moment? Probably pretty hopeless. And in his hopelessness, what does he think? There's nothing I can do to get me out of this situation, but there's a man I know who might. There's one person, my father. My father might look graciously upon me, and if I run to him, maybe he'll welcome me back as a servant. And those of you who know the story of the prodigal son know that's exactly what he does. He's going and he's probably working out in his mind the speech that he's going to make when he goes and he finds his father. He's going to beg for mercy and apologize and seek to work just as a humble servant in his father's house. But when he finds his father's arms are open wide. He's waiting for his son to come back. And his father embraces him and welcomes him into the family, again, as a full-fledged heir in the family. And they throw a big party because his son who was lost is now found. I'd make the argument that God brought that prodigal son to a place of hopelessness for a reason. See, in his arrogance, in his greed and selfishness, he was going to do things his own way forever unless God intervened and brought about some kind of hopeless state or a recognition of hopelessness. And I believe that in part is what the Apostle Paul is doing for us through the Word of God, reminding us of our hopelessness, that there might be some who don't think they're in a hopeless position. They might feel like they've got the world by the tail and that they're able to achieve anything they want to achieve in life. The spiritual reminder for us is here in the Word of God. Without Christ, We are lost, alienated. We do not partake in the promises. We are hopeless. But one of the keys of hopelessness is being able to recognize that without God, we are lost, that we can only run to Him, just as the prodigal son did, to find grace and forgiveness. So at one time, we're separated from Christ. That's point number one. At one time, we are separated from Christ. But point number two is that now we are brought near by the blood of Jesus. But now we're brought near by the blood of Jesus. So in verse 13, it says just that. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off, again, that's all of us, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. Someone might ask, well, if I find myself in the hopeless situation like the prodigal son, can I just return to God? Is that all there is to it? Like the prodigal son, when he went back to his father, did he have to perform to earn the right to come back? Did his dad make him jump through all these hoops? No. Now, there was a sense of repentance, contrition of heart, and a belief that the Father would graciously welcome me back. Sure. But there wasn't anything, as Matt said this morning before the music, there wasn't anything performative that that prodigal son had to do other than accept the grace of God and believe. So can you run to the Father just as the prodigal son did? Well, yes. And the Apostle Paul says, yes, because of Christ Jesus. You who are far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. So because of the blood of Jesus, you can stand before your heavenly Father and not be condemned to death. His death on the cross was done on our behalf so that we didn't have to die for our own sins. He dies for our sin, and that secures what we call atonement. He covers our sins so that we can have forgiveness. So then when our sins are atoned for, we find ourselves in a position not of hostility with God or punishment from God, but in a place of peace and a place of reconciliation because of what Christ did. So the word of God goes on. It says in verse 14, He Himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in His flesh the dividing wall of hostility. Without the work of Jesus, there's this, what the Bible says, hostility between us and God. And this is something that I think the world around us doesn't understand, doesn't believe, doesn't know, in fact, believes just the opposite. And most people in our world would say, if you had to ask them, is God angry with us, or is He a God who just accepts us whoever we are? They would say, no, He's a God who just accepts you whoever you are. He's a God of love, of course, after all, right? And so He would never think of punishing anybody or judging anybody. The world around us, I think, has that misunderstanding about God. They rightly say God is a God of love, but they misapply it and assume then that God would never think of judging anybody. When in fact, the Bible tells us just the opposite, that the position we come before God in without Jesus is a position of hostility, not a position of God just wonderfully accepting us, but a position of punishment. In a place that God would have to judge and then send us to eternity in hell separated from Him. So the word hostility is, I think, a very important word for us to have in our hearts and minds to think, that is what I would have received from God if it wasn't for Jesus. His death on the cross means that the dividing wall of hostility is broken down now, not only between me and God, but me and my other Jewish brothers and sisters. I was once alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, but now I can be brought into the covenants of promise. Now I find myself part of the brotherhood of the saints. The Bible calls the family of God. Not only is this hostility down before me and my God, but there's no longer any hostility between me and the covenant people of God, the family of believers. In Paul's day, they would have called those the Jewish saints. But we call them just the saints now, just the church, because it's Jew, Gentile, it's all people, tribes, and tongues. So Christ Himself destroys the dividing wall of hostility. Where once there was punishment demanded, Christ takes that punishment on Himself. So in verse 15, it says that Christ abolished the law of commandments. He abolishes the law. That's an interesting way to put it. And I think The first time you might think about that phrase, this is the way I thought of it anyway, when you read that he abolished the law, it might be tempting to think, well, that means when Jesus died on the cross, he completely destroyed the necessity of the Old Testament law. Like he just completely did away with it. We never have to think about it, read about it again. And some Christians would go as far as to say that means we don't even need the Old Testament anymore. There's no point in even reading it. All the Ten Commandments are pointless because now God did away with those things. Now all we have is Christ. And I think that's going too far, of course. The Old Testament law is still vitally important. The law reminds us about the standard of God's holiness. But what does a law do? Well, if there is no speeding law, if there's no law against speeding, some of you are going to drive recklessly and some of you are not. Well, the law, the speeding law, is not going to make you reckless, nor is it going to make you good. What does the law do? The law reveals a standard and reminds us of what that standard is. If there was no speeding law, recklessness would still exist. If there was no speeding law, there might be some who would still drive carefully. The law doesn't necessarily make us good drivers, nor does it make us bad drivers. But the law reveals who is following the standard and who is not. The law of God does a similar thing. The law of God doesn't make anybody good, nor does the law of God make anybody bad. The law of God reveals who is living up to God's standard and who is not. And unfortunately, according to the Bible, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, meaning that the law of God reveals everybody is not living up to God's standard. This is why the Apostle Paul says that when Jesus died on the cross, he abolishes the law. He doesn't say that the law is meaningless. He doesn't say that you shouldn't care about the law anymore, because the law of God is good. It helps us see the standard of God and the nature of God in the law. But when it says that he abolishes the law, it means that the consequences and the punishment of the law will no longer fall on you and me if we trust and believe in Christ, because it has already fallen on him. So for you and me, the law, the consequences of the law, the demand of the law is abolished. So Christ destroys this dividing wall of hostility. He abolishes the necessity of the law in demanding punishment. So then he can make one new man, it says. Again, in verse 15, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. Both Gentiles and Jews need Jesus the same. But before Christ came, there was this distinction. And the Apostle Paul is saying now, through Christ, something new has happened. Now there's one body. Now there truly is one body of the church. We are reconciled. We're reconciled not only to God, but we are reconciled together as one church. There is no distinction. There is no Jewish church, Jewish covenant. There is no Gentile Christian church or purely non-Jewish covenant. There is only Christ and the covenant of Christ and the church of Christ, which all believers fall into, Jew, Gentile, any nation, tribe, or tongue who believes in Jesus. The dividing wall of hostility is broken down for anyone who would trust in Christ as their Savior. So then a couple of points of application for this. There's one way to find salvation, to be forgiven of sin and draw near to God, which is through Christ. So two points of application I'd remind you of. First of all, I would call you, as the Bible does, to trust Jesus as your Savior, to accept the gift of salvation that God has given, to be welcomed into the family of God because Jesus died for you. To recognize there's nothing I can do to get myself out of this hopeless situation. There's nothing I can do to reconcile myself to God. I can't make it up to him. How could I make up for my sin against a holy and perfect and just God? I can't. The only one who can is Jesus. It took God in the flesh dying on the cross to make up for my sin, to cover it, to atone for it. I thank God he did, because now I can come into his presence and be accepted. So the first point of application is one that we talk about week in and week out. Turn to God, turn to Christ, and believe. Believe that he's opened the door, just like the prodigal son in that pig pen so many years ago when he knew he was in a hopeless state, but he believed, my Father will give me grace. I can be welcomed into his arms once again. That is the same gift of salvation that's open to us because of what Christ has done. Second point of application I would make to you is this. Because of what Jesus has done, breaking down the dividing wall of hostility, it's possible then for us as Christians to constantly be turning over our guilt and shame. Guilt and shame are things that we carry as people. Whenever we commit sin against God or another person, if we know God and love him, something happens to our conscience. Something happens to our heart. We feel guilt. Guilt is a word that describes being in a bad relationship with a person, literally. So if I offend my wife in some way, I should feel a sense of guilt. The relationship has some kind of barrier between it. If I've done something wrong, that feeling of guilt means I am in the wrong. In reality, I am in the wrong. Not just a perception, not just a feeling, but in actuality, I am in the wrong. So when we carry around that guilt, what we mean to say is, before God, or maybe before other people, I am in the wrong. The work of Jesus allows us to take that feeling and position of guilt and turn it over to God and say, God, because of what Jesus did, I know you'll forgive me and accept me. I don't have to bear the burden and weight of guilt. Yes, I'm going to feel it, but I can turn it over to you and give it to you because of what Jesus has done. I know that I've been forgiven. So God, you can relieve me of the burden of guilt, of not being in a position against you. But then this other word, shame, is slightly different. Shame almost always accompanies guilt, but the word shame is a much more social, communal word. The word shame has to do with a feeling of judgmental or being judged by your community. There's an important difference between the two. See, guilt is a recognition that I'm actually in the wrong. Shame is a feeling that people know that I'm in the wrong. So it's possible to feel guilt with no shame if you've committed a very private sin and nobody knows about it but you and God. You feel guilt, but you don't feel a sense of people pointing the finger at you. You don't feel shame. But maybe you've committed a very public sin and everybody knows about it. So before God and before others, you feel guilty. But you also feel a sense of shame because you know that your peers in your community recognize it. That's what the feeling of shame means. Coming before a group of people and literally feeling like you want to hide, put your head down, or kind of like step back into the shadow so nobody would see you. That's the feeling of shame. It's also possible to feel shame in an illegitimate way. Like to think that people are judging you when actually they're not. You can feel shame when you shouldn't feel shame in some cases. And you can probably see how that works itself out. You can maybe think that other people are pointing the finger or thinking down on you when actually maybe they just aren't. So it's possible to feel those combinations of guilt and shame in all sorts of different ways. And I'm sure that you have felt them in maybe your own sorts of ways as well as you've gone through life. Maybe it's been in the context of a relationship. Maybe it's in the context of family and friends, a neighbor, or in the context of the church. What God has enabled us to do through the work of his son Jesus is to turn over our guilt, turn over our shame, and be able to say Christ has paid for it all. So, we were once far off, but now we're brought near by the blood of Christ. And since we are brought near by the blood of Christ, we are being built together into a dwelling place for God. So point number three is that God is now building us together into a dwelling place for God. And I think verse 22 really sums it up so well. In him, you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. This is the great climactic conclusion of this passage of Scripture. The Apostle Paul starts with hopelessness. Then he reminds us of the grace of God through Christ, breaking down the dividing wall of hostility. But the point and the purpose of all of this is so that you and me as the church can be built into a dwelling place for God. The question we began with at the beginning, what is God up to? The Word of God reveals so many things to us about God's purpose, plan, intentions, His nature, how we relate to Him as a church. There's so many things we find in the Word of God. Sometimes it can be hard to kind of weed through and find, well, what is the main thing? What actually is God up to in our lives, in the church's life? That's it. Verse 22 sums it all up for us. This is the grand objective of the gospel, what God is up to in your life and mine, that we would be built into a dwelling place for God. He describes this in a couple of different ways. He says in verse 18, through him we both have access in one Spirit to the Father. We have access to the Spirit, to God in one Spirit to the Father. That means that everybody who calls upon the name of Jesus has access to God. There are no lower class citizens or upper class citizens. We all have access to God the same. He says in verse 19, you're no longer strangers and aliens. You're not a foreigner to God. You're a fellow citizen with the saints and members of the household of God. Again, the imagery of the family of God being part of his house is at play here. And again, remember in the Old Testament, for the Jewish people, as they worship God in the temple, the Jewish people could come into the temple and worship in a special way. The Gentiles, the foreigners, were left out. There was the court of the Gentiles, the court of the women, where they were allowed to come and worship in their own way, but they weren't allowed into the temple place like the Jewish people were. So there was this dividing wall of hostility, and the Apostle Paul is reminding the church now, that is not the case anymore. You are fellow citizens. We were once foreigners. Even though we might try to worship God as the Jewish person would, we were foreigners, not actually welcomed in citizenship. And what the Apostle Paul is saying now is, no, you're no longer strangers or aliens. You're fellow citizens with the saints, members of the household of God. So the household of God then reminding us that we are together as one family. He says then the whole structure of this family, the household of God, is being built and joined. It's built on the foundation of the apostles, the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, Jesus himself being the cornerstone. If the structure of the church is built on anything other than Jesus, anything other than the foundation of the apostles, it's not the true church. It's not the real household of God. So as a church family, we're built on the apostles, built on the cornerstone of Jesus. And this whole structure, the whole church family, is growing up into a holy temple. Verse 21, in whom the whole structure being joined together grows into a holy temple in the Lord. When it says the household of God, when it talks about the structure, again, not the bricks and mortar of the building, but the people themselves. Those of us who have come to know Jesus as our Savior, we're being joined together, being built up into this dwelling place for God. This is the joy of our salvation. This is what God has been up to. That we are formed into the people who God chooses to dwell with. That's the objective. That's what God's grand design is about. And through God dwelling with us, we glorify God in this. We recognize his work, the miraculous work of him joining us to himself through Christ. The joy of our salvation, though, is that we are becoming the dwelling place of God. God himself calls us, you and me, the holy temple of God. Think about that for just for a few moments. We use the phrase church. There's nothing wrong with calling us the church. It's a great word to use too. But the Bible's full of other important theological words. And one of the ways the Bible describes me and you is to say that we are the holy temple of God. Think about that, church. You and I, the holy temple of God. A couple of points of application as we close then. First of all, a point of warning. Be careful how you talk about the church. A first century Jew would have never been irreverent or disparaging against the temple. They would have never dreamed of talking poorly about the temple. They were even upset when Jesus predicted that the temple would be torn down one day. So think about just how upsetting it would be to a Jewish person to disparage the temple, to talk badly about the dwelling place of God. If a Jewish person would never disparage the temple, never talk down about the church or the temple, how much more then should we consider, as God's people, the church, we are the holy temple of the Lord? How then ought we to talk about the church of God, the temple of God? It can be so tempting to disparage them as being different than us, or to talk down to people even within our congregation as different or other than. We should be also careful to never disparage the church of Christ. Secondly, what comes to my mind as I consider that we are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. That's the grand objective and goal that God had in mind with me and you creating us, drawing us to Himself, to make us His dwelling place. Application number two then is this. There are no rogue dwelling places. There's no such thing as a rogue dwelling place. They don't exist. The Bible doesn't describe Christians as their own dwelling place. The Bible describes us as the church, Jews, Gentiles, all peoples, tribes, and tongues, this local congregation here, along with all the other local congregations of true churches in the area and around the world, as being the church, the temple of God. There are no rogues. And the reason I bring that up and say that is because occasionally I'll hear from different Christians that they don't really care about being part of the church. They want to have a faith in God and the belief, and they might even say, oh, I believe everything the Bible says and I believe that Jesus is the Son of God and that I can have salvation in Him alone. But from time to time, you'll hear from Christians who will say things like, I want God, but I don't want the church. I want to be saved to know God, but you know, I could take or leave the church. I don't really care for them. But the reality is that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you and I are saved to God alone. And that might come as a shock, and that might even feel a little bit controversial, but I assure you it's not. The Bible does not talk about Christians being saved to God alone. The Bible talks about being saved to be a temple, a holy dwelling place, together as the church. We are saved to be with God, with His church family. There is no other image of salvation in the Bible. So if there are people who believe that they can be saved to God without the church, they're just plain wrong. Now hear me out. I'm not saying that you are saved to God through the church or by the church. Ephesians tells us very clearly you're saved by grace through faith. Those are the means and instruments through which God saves you. The church doesn't save you. But if you're looking for a salvation that excludes the church, no such salvation exists in the Bible. In other words, if you're looking for God to offer you salvation without the church, no such offering exists from God. The Bible describes salvation by faith, by grace, into God's family, the household of God, not separate from the household of God. And now, can you imagine talking to an ancient first century Christian about this idea of getting saved but not having anything to do with the church? Can you imagine how surprised a Gentile Christian might be if you said to them, you know, I came to know the gospel. I became a believer many years ago, but you know, I don't really want anything to do with the church because the church is so messed up, so backward. I can't deal with it anymore. So I don't want to deal with it. And so I'm just going to have my faith to myself and the church can do their own thing. Can you imagine how ridiculous and silly and backwards and how astounding that would sound to a first century Gentile? They would say, "Are you crazy? We've been excluded for so long. And now you, with your privilege and the chip on your shoulder, you're just going to say, oh, I don't need the church. God has rescued me to be part of the church. He's broken down the dividing wall of hostility, making us one body. And you're just going to say, no, I don't want that." Can you imagine the audacity to say that to the first century church who's now been joined in one and there's just this like division that has existed for millennia and now it's suddenly healed and made right? Have the audacity to say, no, I don't want that actually. I'm going to go back to the way it was. I'm going to build up a dividing wall of hostility between me and the people of God. It would be insane and ridiculous. That offering of salvation, again, does not exist. So, when we say that we want Christ and we say that we want God, as Christians of his word and the Bible, trusting in what the word of God says, we ought to be able to say we are saved to God with the church. And I believe that there are certain consequences to believing that I can be saved without the church that we see playing out in our culture and day, and we could list all so many of them, but let me just mention a few. I think one of the reasons we see a decline in overall, I'm not necessarily saying for us personally, but overall in the culture of North America, we see a decline in the value of church membership. Why? Maybe for lots of different reasons, but at least one of them I think has to do with this idea that I don't actually need the church. And I don't want to be part of the church. Again, just give me faith in God and that's it. I think one of the reasons we see a decline in membership is for that reason, or at least one of the reasons. People are saying, I don't see the need for it. I don't want it, actually. And if we had a high vision of what God has saved us to, we ought not only want God, we ought want his church as well. We see a decline in church membership. We also see a decline in baptism. Because again, if you put if you connect the dots, baptism has to do with not just identifying yourself with Jesus and saying, I want to be baptized into the likeness of Jesus, into his death and resurrection. I'm going to tell everybody around me that I am a Christian. You're not just saying that when you get baptized. What you're saying is, I want to be identified with Jesus with this church. With this church. That's why so many churches link baptism and membership together. And if you get baptized at our church, I will always make a push and an encouragement for you to also become members with us here at WCC as well. But we see a decline in baptism, and I think one of the reasons for that, again, is just this indifference towards being part of the church. I don't really need it, or I don't really want it. So why would I need to get baptized then? It's just a little add-on. We also see a decline in church attendance. We see a decline in the sanctity of the Lord's Supper for all maybe many reasons, but I think chief of which might be this one. We have abandoned, as a culture, we have abandoned the need for church, for the holy temple of God. So as the Apostle Paul has written these words for us, and God has inspired them, of course, we are reminded that God has given the church to Christ, that he has saved us not simply to himself, but to the church, with the church. You and I are these holy temples, or the church itself is a holy temple being built together into this dwelling place for God. Yes, there are all sorts of consequences that we could enumerate: the decline of church membership, baptism, Lord's Supper, church attendance. But here's the good news. You and I are part of the household of God. My hope is that you'd be encouraged today, encouraged to be reminded of the great aim an objective of God in your life and in my life to make us this holy temple. Together, fellow citizens, we as the church are meant to participate in it It's ours. It belongs to us now. Not in a prideful, selfish way, because God's given it to us. This church is a blessing to us to be part of the holy temple of God. Well, I want to encourage you this morning that you are fellow citizens with God. You are fellow citizens, with the church, a holy temple unto God. Take that blessing and value it and be encouraged by it instead of, devaluing it, instead of deciding, well, I don't really need it, I don't really want it, and worst of all, maybe even disparaging it, talking poorly upon the holy temple of God. No, God has so much more for us. His great objective is that he would be dwelling with us in this wonderful place we call the church. Heavenly Father, as we go to you in prayer, I would pray, Lord, that you would give us this vision for what you want in us as your people, the church. We would see ourselves as this holy temple, despite our imperfections and despite our wanderings. Lord, you've united us together. Thank you for breaking down the dividing wall of hostility so that we can be in your presence, guilt-free and shame-free. But Father, help us to not take for granted this wonderful gift of having your presence with your people, the church, being fellow citizens together as one body. We thank you, Father, for this wonderful gift. Pray that our hearts would reflect the knowledge of being united to you. For it's in Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen.
I invite you to stand as we sing in closing. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise him, for he is my help and salvation. All ye who hear, now to his temple draw near. Praise him in glad adoration. The Lord who bore all things so wondrously reigneth, shelters the under his wings, so gently sustaineth. Hast thou not seen how thy desire?
Heavenly Father, as we leave this place, we do pray that you would send us with your grace and mercy, help us understand just how much you love us and have saved us through your Son. And Father, help us to remember to praise you throughout the week as well, even as this song has reminded us. Praise you, Father, for you are good and for all that you've done for us. But Lord, we pray that you'd send us away with your grace and mercy and safety to bring us back together by your will at the appointed time. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.